Hello there. Hey. I've been asked to talk to you about the social web and how entrepreneurs can take advantage of that. So the way I look at this is that the web keeps developing over time. So it's the web grew out of an open network on open standards. We built it that way so that you could write applications without worrying about things. So you didn't have to worry about where other computers were. You could just send a message to them. That was the first thing that happened. Then when we got to the web, it was, I don't have to worry about where my documents are. I can get those from anywhere in the world. And I don't have to worry about user interfaces. I can just write a form, and the form will post that to the other side of the world where my server is. So there's increasing abstraction over time. Because these abstractions are there, it means basically you have to write less code. So the trend that's been happening over the last year, and the one that we've been very involved with in OpenSocial, is coming up with abstractions for the social part of the web. A year ago, what we saw was there were lots of different social networking sites, and people were spending lots of time on them. But to develop for them was very hard, because each of them had a separate API. You often had to wedge code in there through backdoors or embedding Flash or something like that. So building something that worked across many sites was quite hard. So we put together the OpenSocial initiative to come up with a common set of APIs for social applications on the web to make the social part of the web as easy as writing HTML forms. That's the goal, is make it something you can just rely on being there. And a year on, we're very excited with what's happened with that. I'm speaking today from OpenSocial's first birthday, and we just announced that we have over 600 million users of OpenSocial worldwide across most of the countries in the world. I can't even remember the list of countries. So that's very exciting. But the point of this really is that is to make application development easier. At the moment, if you want to build a social application, you have to find out information about people. And that tends to mean you write a large form for them to fill in, where they have to tell you who they are, where they live, any other personal information you need. And then the second thing you have to do to make it really social is find out who their friends are and gather the same information from them. So you either end up saying, tell me who your friends are, or they have to refriend everyone on your site, or you go into the, let me import your address book and email all your friends and tell them to join my site. And that ends up annoying people more than it helps them. The other thing is, when you build a website that has a big form at the front asking for information, people sort of back away from it and leave. And so you find that what you've got in your database is a sort of bad copy of their real information that they store somewhere else, because they're a set of sites they actually trust with social information, because those sites specialize it and gather it. So what you're able to do with OpenSocial is to draw on those existing sites that have these large collections of social data, build your application that specializes in what you want to do, and then take advantage of the social data that already exists. So you can, whatever your application is about, you can almost always enhance it by making it more social, by making it to something you do with friends. Even if it's just a news site that's telling stories, you're more going to be more interested in stories that your friends have read or recommended than you are in general stories that everyone's looking at. So by adding that little social feedback loop, you can make each experience more interesting. Another aspect of this, now there's in building social applications, there's a lot of talk about becoming viral and spreading. And there's been a set of applications built whose primary goal is to get as many members as possible. We're seeing a backlash against that. What I like to argue is that this is because people are using the wrong metaphor. If you think of yourself as a virus, you're basically saying, I would like to be a disease. I would like to take advantage of people to spread myself, and that's my only goal in life. So what I say to people is think of different metaphors. Think of organic metaphors. Think instead of infecting someone, think of inviting them. So think of how plants work. Plants have fruit. A fruit is a seed, but it has something delicious wrapped around it. If you send someone an invitation that actually makes them happy, they're much more likely to follow through and plant the seed and grow it. So rather than sending out invitations to everyone in the address book, if you let people send out photographs of people that contain them, they're much more likely to look at it. If I get an email with, your friend has a photograph of you, I'm going to look at that, go back and click on that. So think about how you can actually spread this up so it's a natural part of the experience, rather than something you're exploiting for your own ends. Because if you behave like a disease, people develop an immune system and they learn to reject your applications. And that's something we're seeing now. The applications that spread rapidly go up like this and they collapse like that as people start uninstalling them and as containers start banning them. Well, I said container there, so I should back up and explain that a little bit. With OpenSocial, we split the development world into what we call containers and applications. The idea is the container is the custodian of the social data. It's the place that knows who your friends are, knows information about you and them, and can reveal that to the application. Now, clearly, they have to do that with permission of the users. So there are three people involved. There's the container, the application, and the user. And the user chooses which applications to add to the container, and the container manages the personal information, so the application doesn't have to worry about that. And also, the key thing, the value that the application gets from the container is the friends of the user can see that application too, and they can learn to install it. So it can spread rapidly in that way. But as I say, you shouldn't be focusing on spread as your goal. You should be focusing on delighting the users so they want it to spread, rather than they feel like something's taking them over and exploiting them. So the other thing that I want to mention about the growth of OpenSocial and the way it's changed in the last year, up until recently, the model for OpenSocial has been literally having an application embedded inside somebody else's site. So if you've got the container site, the application was part of their page. This has some advantages. It makes the context very clear to the user. It makes it easier to integrate the friend stuff because it's fairly clear what's going on. But the drawback is that you have to write it in JavaScript. And well, you can write some HTML and CSS as well, but primarily you're running a JavaScript application. And plus, your application can only actually run code when somebody's looking at it. So one of the things we added in OpenSocial 0.8 is a REST API, which makes it easier for you to write your application on your own server over here and call into the social network, use the information from there, and present that back to the user there. So what we use is a set of open protocols for that. We use REST, which is the basic standard for communicating on the web. We use OAuth to authenticate that and to let the user say, yes, this application is allowed to do something with my application. And the three parts of OpenSocial are, well, actually there's four parts of OpenSocial that are exposed with REST APIs. The first is the people and contact stuff, finding out who you are, who your friends are, information about you. The second is data persistence. You can actually store data within the container, which means when the app is running in the container, it can have access to that quickly. And also, it handles the hard problem of I'm storing information for one user, I need the information for that user plus his friends. For a large number of users, that's actually quite a hard database problem, but the social networks have already solved that because they already have large numbers of users and they solve that problem every day. So you're basically piggybacking on their ability to do that there. The third one is activity streams. Now, this is the page where you have a list of what you and your friends have done within the social network site. That's been extended with OpenSocial so that anything you do with the applications can show up in there too. And with 0.8, you can run an application remotely and send activities into the site. So if they do something on your site, their friends on the social network can see that too. And again, this adds value for everyone. It adds value for you because the social network where people are watching and loading the page 20 times a day has information about your applications. It adds value for the social network because stuff that's happening elsewhere becomes part of their world. And it adds value for the people because they can keep track of their friends. So again, you know, you have this ability to do this. You could abuse that and fill it with noise, but if you do, you'll get shut down fairly quickly. So think about how you can keep that in a way that adds value to all three. And then the fourth thing is messaging. You can send messages to people through the social network. And this is valuable in that there is a large group of people who have moved from using email as their primary messaging system to using social networks for that, because the social networks are whitelisted. So if your application has gained trust of both parties, it can send messages between them, and that makes that more useful for them too. So the model here is very much adding new infrastructure to the web such that every application you make can become social. The other thing, way of looking at it is, it's freeing you from having to maintain that database of users. One of the things you often have to do when building a web application is to say, okay, I need a user database, I need to start collecting this stuff. And it's a sort of bunch of extra make work you have to do at the beginning before you can focus on what you really want to build. So this means that you can delegate that to other sites and not worry about how that works. And that's a strong piece of the what we're calling the open stack of standard protocols for connecting between sites. There's a set of these, and I won't go into every. There's OpenID, OAuth, and OpenSocial are the three key ones to know about. OpenID means using another site's URL as a login instead of an email address. OAuth means getting authorization, letting user grant permission to access another site in a standardized way. And then OpenSocial is the specification that defines what kind of data you're exchanging over these connections, and also has the connection to the gadget model, so you can actually embed an application entirely inside another site as well.
Great.
Okay. How long was that?